Point number 7, marriage in the Lord. On the threshold of his public life, Jesus performs his first sign at his mother's request during a wedding feast. The church attaches great importance to Jesus' presence at the wedding at Cana. She sees in it the confirmation of the goodness of marriage and the proclamation that thenceforth marriage will be an efficacious sign of the presence of Christ. That you find in the Catechism of the Church, number 1613, paraphrased from the Gospel according to John, chapter 2, from verse 1 through 11. Now, the church continues. This unequivocal insistence on the indissolubility of the marriage bond may have left some perplexed and could seem to be a demand impossible to realize. However, Jesus has not placed on spouses a burden impossible to bear or too heavy, heavier than the law of Moses. No, by coming to restore the original order of creation disturbed by sin, he himself gives the strength and the grace to be able to live marriage in the new dimension of the reign of God. It is by following Christ, renouncing themselves and taking up their crosses that spouses will be able to receive the original meaning of marriage and live it with the help of Christ. This grace of Christian marriage is a fruit of Christ's cross, the source of all Christian life. This we find in the Catechism of the Church, number 1615. We are still discussing marriage in the law. This is a word that Apostle Paul makes clear when he says, "Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her." Adding words, "For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one. This is a great mystery, and I mean in reference to Christ and the church." Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 to 26, 31 to 32. Paraphrased in the church catechism, number 1616. Let's look at our point number 8. Virginity for the sake of the kingdom. According to the Catechism of the Church, number 1619, he said that virginity for the sake of the kingdom of heaven is an unfolding of baptismal grace, a powerful sign of the supremacy of the bond with Christ and of the ardent expectation of his return, a sign which also recalls that marriage is a reality of this present age which is passing away. Matthew chapter 19, verse 12, Mark chapter 12, verse 25, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and verse 31. What the church is trying to say is that there are people who remain virgins for the sake of Christianity. Just like St. Paul said, it is better for, I want everybody to be like I, as I am, unmarried. But he said, if you cannot control yourself, you better go and get married. So the church is trying to say that there are people who remain virgin, who remain unmarried for the sake of the kingdom because of their bond with Christ and their expectation of the soon, the second coming of Jesus or the perfect restoration of things. Point number 9, let's look at the celebration of marriage. The celebration of marriage. According to the Latin tradition, the spouses, as ministers of Christ's grace, mutually confer upon each other the sacrament of matrimony by expressing their consent before the church. In the traditions of the Eastern churches, the priests, that's the bishops or the presbyters, are witnesses to the mutual consent given by the spouses. But for the validity of the sacrament, their blessing is also necessary. As for the validity of the sacrament, the blessing of the priest is necessary. This we find in Canon 828 and also Catechism of the Church, number 1623. That is just trying to let us know that the celebrant actually of marriage is the couple. The various liturgies are bound in the prayers of blessing and epiclesis, asking God's grace and blessing on the new couple, especially the bride. In the epiclesis of this sacrament, the spouses receive the Holy Spirit as the communion of love of Christ and the church. The Holy Spirit is the seal of their covenant, the ever available source of their love and the strength to renew their fidelity. CCC number 1624. I want you to understand what the church is saying, that the Holy Spirit is the seal of their fidelity. When marriage is validly contracted, there is a seal. When you hear marriage bond, there is a seal, and the Holy Spirit is that seal. In mathematics, there's what is known as variation and then constant. That means if A varies, whether directly, indirectly, or jointly as B, in mathematics, A will never become B until there is a constant introduced. I'm talking mathematical wise. If A varies jointly, directly, indirectly as B, A will never become B until there is a constant. So A will only equal to B when a constant is introduced. In marriage, marriage is between two variants. The husband is a variant, the wife is a variant, and therefore they will never become one until a constant is introduced. The Holy Spirit is the marriage constant. The Holy Spirit is the marriage constant. He's the one that is always available. That is why when you are married, you can never be alone. The Holy Spirit as a constant is always with the husband representing the wife, and always with the wife representing the husband. That means you cannot say, well, where I am now, my wife is not available, my husband is not available, let me do what I want, let me behave as if I am not married. There is a constant. He's not a variant. He doesn't change. There's no shadow of turning with him. He's the constant in every marriage. That is the Holy Spirit. And that's why you can never do anything and say, nobody knows what I did in this marriage, because there is a constant. He never leaves you. So the earlier the better, we understand that the Holy Spirit is the constant in the marriage equation. The Holy Spirit is the constant in the marriage equation. That takes us to our point number 10. Matrimonial consent. Matrimonial consent. The parties to a marriage covenant are a baptized man and woman, free to contract marriage, who freely expresses their consent. And to be free means, number one, that they are not being under constraints, and number two, they are not impeded by any natural or ecclesiastical law. By any natural or ecclesiastical law, impediment is a barrier to consent, either by natural, like affinity or consanguinity, or ecclesiastical law. This you find in the Catechism of the Church, number 1625. We are talking about matrimonial consent. The Church continues. The Church holds that the exchange of consent between the spouses is the indispensable element that makes the marriage. If consent is lacking, there is no marriage. The consent consists in a human act by which the partners mutually give themselves to each other. In the words, I take you to be my wife, I take you to be my husband. This consent that binds the spouses to each other finds its fulfillment in the two becoming one flesh. That you find in number 1626 to 627. What the Church is trying to say is that the indispensable element of matrimony is consent. The most important element of matrimony that makes the marriage is consent. And the Church continues, the consent must be an act of the will of each of the contracting parties, free of coercion or grave external fear. No human power can substitute for this consent. If this freedom is lacking, the marriage is invalid. According to law, there's what is known as void or voidable marriage. If this consent is lacking, the marriage is invalid, is void, ab initio. For this reason, or for other reasons that render the marriage a nullity, the church, after an examination of the situation by the competent ecclesiastical tribunal, can declare the nullity of a marriage. That means that the marriage never existed. In this case, the contracting parties are free to marry, provided that the natural obligations of a previous union are discharged. That you find in Canon 1057, Canon 1071, CCC 1628 to 1629, meaning that if this consent is lacking and there is even children, there are children that have resorted to that so-called union, the church says no marriage happened and each party is free to go and marry, but there should be obligation of the fruits of such previous union that should be discharged. So consent is the most important element in marriage, in Christian marriage, in matrimony. Where there's no consent, there's no marriage, and nobody or nothing else can substitute it. According to Gadium Express, paragraph 49, as recorded in Catechism number 1632, it is imperative to give suitable and timely instruction to young people, above all, in the hearts of their families, about the dignity of married life, married love, its role, and its exercise, so that, having learned the value of chastity, they will be able at a suitable age to engage in honorable courtship and enter upon a marriage of their own. In the family is so important. That's why we'll be talking about building a solid family next time. It's so important. That is where preparation is done. Many mishaps, many ills that follow marriages are as a result of poor preparation or lack of it in the family for young children. So what you are sharing is very, very profound and very, very important. Let's look at point number 11. Mixed marriages and what is known as disparity of court. Mixed marriages and disparity of court. According to Catechism number 1633, it provides, in many countries, the situation of a mixed marriage arises. What is mixed marriage? Marriage between a baptized Catholic and a baptized non-Catholic. It often arises and requires particular attention on the part of couples and their pastors. A case of marriage with disparity of court, meaning between a Catholic and a non-baptized person, requires even greater circumcision. What the church is trying to say here is that the church can never forbid you from marrying anybody after proper scrutiny and guide and counsel. So there is mixed marriage. As a Catholic, the church will not stop you from marrying a non-Catholic as long as it's a baptized Christian. That is the meaning of mixed marriage. But the church, trying to protect your faith, will give you guidance, will give you direction to make sure that you understand what you are doing, to make sure that you are not under coercion, to make sure that you are not being deceived. And they will even have session with your spouse to be, to make sure that as much as is possible, your faith would be preserved. And if possible, you also raise your children in the faith. The same with disparity of court. If you want to marry a pagan, the church cannot stop you. It's your marriage, it's your life. If you want to marry a Muslim, the church cannot stop you. Anyone you want to marry, the only thing the church owes you is guidance, direction, so that you will not say later, I was not properly guided, I did not know. The church will guide you. And once there is assurance that your faith will be preserved, that even your children will be raised in the faith, the church will go ahead to marry you, to wed you, even with the person. That is the meaning of disparity of court. So, the church supports you in any way, but wants you to have the best. Point number 12. Let's look at the effects of the sacrament of matrimony. 12a, we talk of the marriage bond. The marriage bond. That is a word that many people use without understanding the meaning. And the church expounds in number 1639, the consent by which the spouses mutually give and receive one another is sealed by God himself. I repeat, is sealed by God himself. From their covenant arises an institution confirmed by the divine law, even in the eyes of society. The covenant between the spouses is integrated into God's covenant with man. Authentic married love is cut off into divine love. Catechism of the Church number 1339 is very profound. It says that once consent is given mutually, that it is sealed by God himself. Marriage is dangerous. It's not a contract of I come in today, I go out tomorrow. Marriage involves God. God seals that covenant. And that is what is meant by the marriage bond, that God seals it. Either you call it seal or you call it bond, that there is something that God is involved that binds a man to a woman to a man in the sacrament of matrimony. Thus, the marriage bond has been established by God himself in such a way that a marriage concluded and consummated between baptized persons can never be dissolved. I repeat, can never be dissolved. This bond, which results from free human act of the spouses and their consummation of the marriage, is a reality, henceforth irrevocable. Henceforth irrevocable, and gives rise to a covenant guaranteed by God's fidelity. The church does not have the power to contravene this disposition of divine wisdom. I repeat, the church does not have the power to contravene this disposition of divine wisdom. That we find in the teaching of the church, number 1640, CCC, 1640. That this bond, having been established and consummated, can never be dissolved. Can never be dissolved. Before you say, I do, I do, you need to understand the meaning of sacrament of matrimony. You need to understand marriage in the kingdom of God, or according to the kingdom of Christianity. It's not about cultural marriage. It's not a contract you can work into today and work out tomorrow. It's an unbreakable bond. It is a seal that cannot be broken. And therefore, every married person is under a bond. And a bond is a short word, according to my explanation, of bondage. Just add A-G-E to it. It is called that every married person is under bondage. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Every married person is under bondage. What does that mean? You are not free to do what you want. You are not free to act as you want. So if you don't want to be under bondage, don't marry. That was the reason St. Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, it's better for you not to marry, because anybody who is going to marry is going to face difficulties. One of them is the bondage of loss of freedom, unquote. And you can, but it's not something you can say, hey, I thought it would work, we no longer work. Let me work away. God is involved, and God is the one that seals it. God is the one that seals it. And because God is the one that seals it, you are not to break it. 12b, the unity and indissolubility of marriage. Flowing from the bond or bondage comes the unity and indissolubility of marriage. And the church continues in number 1645. The unity of marriage, distinctly recognized by our Lord, is made clear in the equal personal dignity which must be accorded to man and wife in mutual and unreserved affection. Polygamy is contrary to conjugal love, which is undivided and exclusive. Polygamy is contrary to conjugal love, which is undivided and exclusive, meaning polygamy is anti-Christian. Polygamy is not kingdom marriage. Polygamy is not welcome in the eyes or in the sight of God with regard to the sacrament of matrimony. Matrimonial love is undivided, so you cannot be married to a woman and have extramarital affair. You are breaking you are harming yourself. That is the point we are making. The unity and indissolubility of marriage. Marriage is not as easy as we think. So, point number 13, the fidelity of conjugal love. By its very nature, conjugal love requires the inviolable fidelity of the spouses. This is the consequence of the gift of themselves which they make to each other. Fidelity is a consequence of the gift of themselves that they make to each other. Meaning, out of the whole world, people in the world, you decide to choose one person. It's your choice. It has a consequence. That consequence is fidelity. You see, you may not be able to choose the country where you can be, where you are to be born. Or you did not choose where you were born. You did not also choose the family to which you were born. But when it comes to life partner, God says, choose he who finds a wife. So there is a consequence of your choice. Fidelity is the consequence of the gift of themselves, which they make to each other. So love seeks to be definitive. It cannot be an arrangement until further notice. No. The intimate union of marriage as a mutual giving of two persons and the good of the children demand total fidelity from the spouses and require an unbreakable union between them. An unbreakable union between them. Catechism of the Church number 1646. Especially with regard to children, it requires an unbreakable union. The deepest reason is found in the fidelity of God to his children, in that of Christ to his church. Through the sacrament of matrimony, the spouses are enabled to represent this fidelity and witness to it. Through the sacrament, the indissolubility of marriage receives a new and deeper meaning. According to CCC number 1647. Now, what we are trying to say here is the fidelity of conjugal love. When it comes to marriage, the man and the woman are nothing but specimen. The man and the woman, they are both specimen of marriage. Actual marriage is a bond, a fidelity representing the covenant of God and the man. That is point number one. Point number two, according to Ephesians chapter 5, is a representation of the union of Christ and the church. So every married man is just a specimen of the Christ. Every married woman is a specimen of the church. That's what makes marriage dangerous. In case you don't know, marriage is dangerous. Marriage is never about man. It's not about husband and wife. Marriage is about Christ and the church. So every man is just a specimen. That is why you will be married forever, but you will not be a husband forever. Why? Even though you are just a husband, you are a temporary specimen. When the true husband comes, which is Jesus, you give way. Why? You are just a representative. And guess what? You are going to be judged according as how you were able to represent Jesus, the true husband. Every woman, every wife is going to be judged according to how she was able to represent the true wife, the church. And therefore, anything a man does to his wife, spiritually the angels are recording that you are saying that this is how Christ treats the church. Anything a woman does to her husband, spiritually you are saying this is how the church treats Christ. And that's what makes marriage dangerous. Marriage is not for boys. It's not for Tom, Dick, and Harry. It's for the enlightened. Those who understand they are representing the fidelity of God and man, the fidelity of Christ and the church. And you are going to give account. You are just in a representative capacity. True husband is coming and the original wedding is coming. We are all looking forward to the marriage supper of the Lamb, the wedding of all weddings. Every other thing that we are doing on earth, they are both temporary and just in a representative capacity. So, if you cannot represent Christ, don't marry. If you cannot represent the church in a marriage, don't marry. Marriage is not by force. There is a consequence, what I call marriage being dangerous. Thank you.